thank you to Stefano, and thanks also to Marcelo and Jean-Christophe for organizing this school and later this conference. So I came here several times. It's always a huge pleasure. I followed many courses. I learned a lot. So now I hope this one could be fruitful for you. So it will be with Raphaël here. We wrote some notes that will be on the web page.
The lecture notes will be on the website. Oh. Should be on the website
already.
OK. So they will be later today.
OK. There are some mistakes we are correcting. So if you find other one, you should tell us. OK, so let's start. So the subject is partial hyperbolicity. But let's start with something a bit more general. So we are interested by differentiable dynamics. So we are on a manifold. Which is compact, boundaryless. And we are interested by discrete dynamics, so a diffeomorphism. So sometimes we precise a CR diffeomorphism. And the topic of this lecture is to discuss some particular class of this diffeomorphism, because there are few things we can say about general diffeomorphism. But to start with, let's say something general, which is how to. So today it will. This morning will be more motivations. So how to decompose the dynamics. Decomposition of the dynamics. So there are several ways. I will present now, which is quite natural. So to decompose the dynamics, what you look for are attracting region, trapping region. So a trapping region is an open set which is whose closure is mapped into itself. So if you have the manifold, U is below and it's mapped into itself. And now if you iterate the region, any orbit here in U is attracted by a set. A limit set, the attractor of U, which is compact and invariant. And you can do the same in the past. So you define kind of repeller. Which is also compact and invariant. And the other orbits have to go through this middle region. So you have you decompose the manifold in three parts, R, A, and this region, O. So it's given by the iterate of U minus F of U. So points here are not recurrent at all. So they come from R and end at A. So it's highly non-recurrent. So you're mainly interested by orbits in R or in A. So that's what you have if you have one such region. But then you can change the region. And again, you're interested by the corresponding R and A, and you trash the other point. So if you trash all the points in the non-recurrent part for all the region U, what remains is what we called the chain recurrence set. So this is the intersection of M minus O for all trapping region U. So U is open and invariant. So this set is compact and invariant. So we want to understand the dynamics in this set. And this set naturally splits into a collection of invariant compact sets. So because you may define a relation, so if you take x, y in R, the chain recurrence set, you say x is equivalent to y if each time you have a trapping region, this cannot separate x from y. So either x and y belong to U or x and y belong to its complement. So it's an equivalence relation, and the equivalence classes are called the chain recurrent classes. And they are compact and invariant, because this relation is closed and invariant. So this is something we would like to understand in general. How does it split? Maybe there is only one class. Maybe there are several ones, maybe infinitely many ones. So it's a first property we would like to understand. Okay, there is another way to define these objects. So, other way, which explains the word chain. So, a chain is another name for pseudo orbit. So, if you fix epsilon, you say that a sequence in M is an epsilon pseudo orbit. If so, for any n, the distance between the image of xn and xn plus 1 is less than epsilon. So it's like an orbit, but you allow some error at each iteration. And then R of f is the set of points that are recurrent for pseudo orbit. So for any epsilon, there is an epsilon pseudo orbit from x to itself. Well, you have to specify that you have at least 2 points, because otherwise it's trivial. And then you may define the equivalence relation in another way. So x is equivalent to y if, for any epsilon, there is an epsilon pseudo orbit from x to y, and another one from y to x. Again, n, m larger or equal to 1, so they are epsilon pseudo orbit. Okay. So something we could discuss in the tutorial is why these two notions are equivalent. So I don't know, for the tutorial we will see, I propose something, we can discuss any other thing, maybe one indication. is if you have, if you fix a point and epsilon, you may try to understand this set, the set of point y that you can attain from x by epsilon pseudo orbit. Again, n larger or equal to 1. So try to understand how this set looks like. OK, so this was something general. Even for homeomorphism, it makes sense. So now let's discuss some more particular class of systems. So before talking about partial hyperbolicity, let's talk about hyperbolicity, uniform hyperbolicity. So many of you maybe have know some about uniform hyperbolicity. I'm not sure all of you. I'd like to quickly give the definition and then give the main property. So uniform hyperbolicity. So we are still with a diffeomorphism F. And we consider K compact invariant set, and we say that it is hyperbolic if so for any point you may look to the tangent space at x. So if you want to simplify, you may imagine M is a torus, and so you, so okay. And then, so that this linear space have splitting into two linear spaces. With the property that, so you have invariance. For any x, the image of ES is the space ES at the image. And the same for EU. Okay. And then you have you have contraction of ES. So there exists C and lambda smaller than 1, such that for any point and for any positivity rate, so the norm of DF at X along the space ES N iterates is smaller than C lambda N. So this is contraction along ES, and you have, so the definition is symmetric in the time, so now if you reverse time, you have contraction along EU. Okay? So this is very classical. What is less standard is how to define a hyperbolic diffeomorphism. So there is one definition I like, and I am fighting to promote this definition. So So with what I said before, it's very natural. You say F is hyperbolic if any of its chain recurrent class is hyperbolic, is a hyperbolic set. Okay. And there is another equivalent definition. It's the fact that R of F can be decomposed as invariant compact set that are hyperbolic. So I'm not taking saying here that there are the chain recurrent classes. I'm not assuming fine tests of chain recurrence classes, for instance. So to see the equivalence, it could be an exercise. No. Here, the hyperbolicity is in restriction to the chain recurrent set. I will give you example. So what is more standard is to talk about what is called axiome. So I don't want to give the definition, but for those who know more, but we can discuss this if you're interested. It's to show the link with a more classical definition. So in fact, it is equivalent to not axiome, but axiome plus no cycle condition. Okay? But, okay. It's for more advanced people, maybe. So some very classical examples. So one case is when the whole manifold is a hyperbolic set. M is a hyperbolic set. So we say that in this case, F is another. So famous example is this. So a linear automorphism on the two torus. So this integral matrix acts on R2, but preserves Z2. So you may take the question, which is a two torus. And it is a hyperbolic. At the opposite, you may have a very small chain recurrent set. So you may have a chain recurrent set which is finite. So a finite union of periodic points that are, each of them is a hyperbolic set. So hyperbolic periodic orbit. So here, it's almost what we call Morse-Mail diffeomorphism. In the definition of Morse-Mail diffeomorphism, there is another technical assumption I don't precise here. So a very simple example on the circle, you had some sink and some sources. Yes. Then you may have a more complicated example, maybe more complicated. So you have the horseshoe. So the horseshoe. Is defined so on the sphere you have, or in the plane, you have a rectangle R which is mapped onto itself this way. But inside R, the horizontal and the vertical are preserved. So you see the vertical is stretched, so it will give the unstable direction. The vertical and the horizontal is contracted, so it's a stable direction. And if you take the consider the orbit which don't exit, you find a contour set. And at last, there are attractors. So you may have periodic points that attract. There are things, but you may have a more complicated attractor. So one example is a Plekin attractor. I don't want to give the construction, just to say that, so again, in the sphere or in the plane, so you have a hyperbolic set, so it attracts any point in a neighborhood, but the set itself is locally homeomorphic to a product, so to a contour set times a line, times the interval. And the dynamics, so stretch along this line, so EU is here, and contracts transversely. It's not so easy to see how to build that. We did some picture in the notes. Okay, so let's summarize some important property, because it will be our starting point for partial hyperbolicity. So maybe three. So one important property is the shadowing. So it says that if you consider a pseudo orbit, so an orbit with zero, it is shadowed by a true orbit. So for any epsilon, there is delta, such that, so let's consider K hyperbolic set. F. And so each time you have an epsilon pseudo orbit in K, then there is a point in M such that the orbit of X stays close to the pseudo orbit. So at any iterate, it is delta close. So this, which seems maybe technical, it has many consequences. So an important consequence for us is a spectral decomposition. It will be one of the main subjects in these lectures. So spectral decomposition tells that if F is hyperbolic, then the number of chain recurrent classes is finite. Finite, And then, so each chain recurrent class has some recurrence, but recurrence by pseudo orbits. And in fact, in the hyperbolic setting, it's better. So any class is transitive. So not only we can travel inside the class by pseudo orbit, but we can travel by a single orbit. So there is, it contains a dense half orbit, forward orbit, which is the same as containing a dense backward orbit. So two other consequences of this lemma. One is the stability. So if F is hyperbolic, then any G, which is C1 close, is also hyperbolic. So hyperbolic CT is an open property. But not only that, the dynamics on their chain recurrent set are conjugate. So there is a homeomorphism. Which conjugate. So HF is equal to GF. So the dynamics remain the same after perturbation. And the last property related to the shadowing is the existence of coding, or we have Markov partition. So there is a symbolic representation of the system. Of F restricted to the part that we want to understand. Just as an example, for the horseshoe, then it is conjugated so to a symbolic system which is the space of sequences of 0 and 1 where the shift acts. So we understand very well the dynamics. So then some other properties that are important. So one is to understand the geometry of hyperbolic sets. It's the famous stable manifold theorem. So it says that if K is hyperbolic, and if you take a point in K, then you may look to points that have the same feature as X, so what we want to call the stable set. So points whose feature orbit gets closer and closer to the orbit of X in the future. So this is, so usually it's written WS of X, it is a submanifold, is an immersed submanifold. Immersed because it may accumulate itself. Then, another property is a description of a statistical description of the dynamic. So let's take F, a hyperbolic diffeomorphism. In general, it's difficult to understand the future of any orbit, but we are happy sometimes if we understand the orbit for almost every point. So this is the case. And we have some finiteness of the possibility. So there are finitely many probability measures. So that for almost every point, so what does it mean, almost every point? It means if you take any volume, it's almost every point for this measure induced by the volume. If you change the volume, you have the same notion of almost every point. Then the future of X distributes according to one of these measures. There is I such that. So you look to the statistic of this orbit. So you put Dirac masses along the forward, a piece of the forward orbit. This is a I-normalized, this is a probability measure, and it converges to one of these measures for usual convergence of measures. And then you may study the ergodic properties of this measure. I won't talk about this now. And a last property. It's the fact that, okay, we would like maybe to understand all the hyperbolic system and to classify them. We are far from being able to do that, but there are some results. So, for example, so the hyperbolicity could constrain the dynamics and the manifold. So, for instance, there is one result by Newhouse, Franks, and Newhouse. Well, I didn't give any name, but so let's assume that F is anosov and M connected, and that the unstable direction is one-dimensional. Then M has to be a torus, and the dynamics is conjugated. To a linear automorphism, very similar to the one I gave at some moment. So, it's quite rigid. Another thing we understand, so in dimension one, hyperbolic diffeomorphism are exactly those I described on the circle. In dimension two, hyperbolic diffeomorphism, so according to the spectral decomposition, breaks into finitely many classes, and each of these classes has to, so looks like one of the examples I gave. So either it's anosov, or you have isolated periodic orbit, or you have a contour set like the horseshoe, or you have an attractor repeller, which is similar to a Plekin attractor. But in higher dimension, we don't understand. Okay, do you have a question? No? So let's go to partial hyperbolicity. So one goal is to relax the notion of uniform hyperbolicity to address a larger class of system. So the way is this one. So you first define what is a partially hyperbolic set. So again, you have fixed diffeomorphism F. You take a compact invariant set. And you say it is partially hyperbolic if, so for any point x, the tangent space can be decomposed into linear subspaces. So I didn't precise in the hyperbolic setting, you had two spaces. The first is called stable, the last is called unstable. Here you allow a third one called the center. Stable. And you require so invariance. As before, so here sigma would be S, U, or C. You require that ES and EU are contracted, so ES is contracted by DF, EU by df minus 1, as before. And you have a center part, which is dominated. So invariance, contraction, and domination. So domination means there is I will. So this is a presentation, but introduction. But this afternoon, I will describe in more details this notion. So domination means each time you take vector. So for any point x, you want to compare what happens along the stable. So you take a vector. In ES, in EC, and in EU, that are non-zero. And you want to understand how they are contracted or expanded by forward iteration. And so, for instance, if you look to the middle part, this is the reason I took it non-zero, it's less expanded along EU. So, because you have this factor, and it's more expanded that along ES. Have a similar factor. Okay. So the hyperbolic case is just a case the center bundle is trivial. We don't want that to have only a center bundle, because in this case there is no information. But sometimes we allow one of the extreme bundles to disappear, because, for instance, in the hyperbolic case, you may have only the stable if you have a sink, an attracting periodic point. So at least one of this bundle, ES, EU, is non-trivial. So for the moment, I won't give more example. So you have already hyperbolic example. A very simple example is you take an anosov system on M, and you do the product with the identity on M2, on another manifold, you do the product, and you can check it is partially hyperbolic. The center bundle is a tangent space to M2. So one goal is to understand how to extend the previous property to this more general setting. This larger class of systems. I won't discuss all the properties I have introduced, but there are also other motivations for studying partial hyperbolicity. It's not just trying to generalize. It's also because sometimes partial hyperbolicity appears as a natural class. So as I said, one property we will discuss a lot is spectral decomposition. So in particular, discuss the spectral decomposition. So what I mean is essentially the finiteness of the number of classes. But there are systems, there are large class of systems that are not partially hyperbolic, but that have infinitely many classes. A famous example is the Newhouse phenomenon. So let me recall what it is. So if you start with a C2 surface diffeomorphism, which exhibits homoclinic tangency, homoclinic tangency mean that there is a periodic orbit, a hyperbolic periodic orbit, O, hyperbolic set, so you have stable and unstable manifold. And there is a point P in O, such that the stable manifold of P and the unstable manifold of P have a non-transverse intersection point. Okay. So something like that. If you think to a fixed point, saddle, meaning you have one-dimensional unstable, one-dimensional stable. So you have two invariant manifold, the stable, and looking to the past, you have the unstable manifold. And you may require that these manifolds that are curved have a tangency. In this case, you may check that F is not hyperbolic. And what Newhaus has proved is that then there is an open set of system of C2 diffeomorphism. So F is in the boundary of U. And in U, so any G in a dense subset of U. No, not only it's dense, but it's a J delta dense. Of U has infinitely many sinks or sources. So sinks are periodic points that are attracting, sources are hyperbolic periodic points that are repelling. So there are particular case of chain recurrent classes. So in this case, you have infinitely many classes. So this seems a wild behavior. Not only you have infinitely many classes, but also to describe the, so these classes here are simple, but you have many other ones which are much more complicated that could appear. So to describe the system is a very difficult subject. So you would like to characterize systems which have only finitely many classes. So systems with finitely many classes. So this is something we don't know in full generality, but let me just give a statement. So one case is a case you have only a single class. So let's say F is, so one example you have a single class is when you have a dense orbit. So F is transitive. And you say F is robustly transitive if any G diffeomorphism C1 close is transitive, as a dense orbit. And there is a theorem. So by Bonatti, Diaz, Pujals. So I have something a bit more general, but which tells that if F is robustly transitive, and let's assume M connected, then F is not partially hyperbolic, but volume hyperbolic, which is quite related. So it says that, but globally, yeah, the whole manifold is a volume hyperbolic set, meaning, so to summarize, you have a splitting, like for partial hyperbolicity, but here it's not uniformly contracted, maybe, and here not uniformly expanded, but you still have invariance and domination. But what you have, I won't detail much, is that you don't have uniform contraction here, but you have contraction of the volume along this space. In the future, and along ECU in the past. And so, for instance, in particular, in dimension 3, you're partially hyperbolic. M is partially hyperbolic. This is one case. Another example where partial hyperbolicity appears. So you see that homoclinic tangency may generate wild behavior, so high complexity. So you may want to characterize those systems which don't exhibit homoclinic tangency. So far from homoclinic tangency. So let me state one theorem. So I proved with Enrique Pujals, Martin Sambarino, Dawei Yang. So it says that if you fix the manifold in a space of C1 diffeomorphism, you find two regions. Closed region, an open, they are disjoint, and the union is dense. With the property that F, if you take F in T, then F is limit of diffeomorphism exhibiting tangency. Okay. And if you take F in O, then F is partially hyperbolic. In a stronger sense than what I have said up to now, so any class is either hyperbolic or has a splitting so ES EU. And the center part splits into one-dimensional bundles. And here, ES and EU are non-trivial. So this is a... And so this forbids the existence of tangency clause. So this is a good setting to try to understand all these properties, to try to generalize all these properties of hyperbolic system. I have a few minutes more, yeah? So what to say. So one goal is to extend the, as I said, the previous property to this larger class of system. Another motivation for partial hyperbolicity is that we have many examples, natural examples, that appear in various settings. So Raphael will talk about that tomorrow. This we will discuss on Thursday. We will talk about robust transitivity, and on Friday about finiteness for attractors. Then what about the other properties? We talked about so invariant manifolds, so this will be addressed on Wednesday. Well, I hope. And there are many other subjects with partial hyperbolicity we won't talk at all about. So other subjects. So there are many ones, but some one that are been much developed in the past year are so the problem of physical measure. So there's measure that I described in the hyperbolic setting. And in particular, if the system is preserves the volume, you have a natural measure and you'd like to know if it is ergodic. So ergodicity when a volume is preserved. And another subject that has been much developed is the problem of classification. Raphael maybe will talk a bit about that tomorrow, so mainly in dimension 3. But if you look to the literature, you will see that partial hyperbolicity appears at many places because it's a very natural setting to extend some properties. And usually, the first case one looks at is a case the center is dimension 1. And then a second case would be to address a case you have a sum of several one-dimensional centers. Okay, so, and this afternoon it's more to discuss the definition and the basic properties. So, thank you.